Moinsen, this is Sebastian, and this is the order and build instruction video for the GB Interceptor. If you don't know what the GB Interceptor is, please watch the main video first. In this one, you will learn how to order parts and assemble the thing. But you first want to know what it is, right? Still here? So you know what the Interceptor is and you want to build one? Then, before you start, please make sure that you understand the limitations I mentioned in the main video and also understand that I'm describing a DIY project here. I think that the result works nicely, but it is not a product and there is no warranty, liability or customer service from my side. I usually help gladly, but the baseline is that you are on your own and anything that you damage in the process is your own fault. Also, check out the GitHub page for this project to learn about the current state, known bugs and known incompatibilities. In theory, this is a USB video class device that should work universally without drivers, but it uses a rather unusual format that is not supported by all software and at the moment when this video is being published, it is not yet working on macOS at all. That being said, I will try to help if I have the time. Please avoid asking me for help on private channels as it is very likely that others will have the same question. Instead, please post your question on my subreddit and report issues on GitHub. You can find both links in the description. Finally, as already said in the main video, I highly recommend that you order in groups with a few friends. The cost per unit drops significantly if you order a batch of 5 or even better 10 units. I ordered parts for 10 prototypes and spent less than 25 euros per unit, but buying only 2 would have easily cost me more than 100 euro just for the PCB. Okay, now that this is out of the way, let's get building. The instructions are structured into 4 steps. First, order PCBs with assembly service and additional parts. Second, solder the cartridge slot. Third, upload the firmware to the device. And finally, build a case. At the moment, there are 2 options for the case. Either the minimal one made from a repro cartridge shell or a 3D printed one. Which additional parts you need in step 1 will depend on which case you want to build. Also, if you're watching this video sometime after release, please check out the GitHub repository in the video description first for alternative cases that might have been added by the community and maybe some additional info that was added later. We start with the maybe most complicated part, ordering the PCBs. As you have seen in the main video, this project is being sponsored by JLC PCB and that is where I ordered my prototypes even before they sponsored me. So in this video, we will also order from there. After all, this is what I have already tested successfully. First, if you have never ordered anything from JLC PCB, create an account on jlcpcb.com. If you want to support my work, I would kindly ask you to use the link under the video to do so, because that is an affiliate link that gives me a little commission if you register and order through it for the first time. Now, if you're logged in, select Order Now in the top right corner to get to the page with all those technical options. Before we go through those, we need to upload Gerber files. These are the files that tell JLC PCB exactly what the PCBs should look like. Luckily, we can upload all of them as a single zip file, which you can get from a GitHub repository. So, in a second tab of your browser, go to the GitHub link from the video description. Here, look for releases on the right-hand side to go through the latest version that I packed for you. You will see different files for the PCB, the firmware and the 3D printed case. In this first step, you need to download gbinterceptor_pcb_gerber.zip, then switch back to the GLC PCB tab and simply drag the freshly downloaded zip file onto the Add Gerber File button. When the site has finished processing, you should see the front and back of the Interceptor PCB, including the parts that we later need to break away. Now it is time to look at all those options. The first ones should be left as they are. The material is FR4, this PCB has 2 layers and the dimensions have automatically been set up by the uploaded files. Then it is time to select the number of PCBs. Here I will pick 10 because that is what I ordered the last time. Note that you can only select a minimum of 5 PCBs and multiples thereof. You can, however, select to assemble only 2 of those 5 PCBs later, if you really want to order the absolute minimum. You would get 3 PCBs without components and 2 assembled ones. But as I said, ordering larger amounts makes much more sense as the setup fees per order are heavier than the cost for the components. Next, leave product type on the consumer electronics setting. On to the PCB specifications. Here we need to change different design from 1 to 2. This indicates to JLC PCB that although we only uploaded one set of Gerber files, they contain two PCBs, the interceptor and the extension board. This is called panelization, and since we did it ourselves, this also changes the next setting to panel by customer. Now, the next setting is a really important one. The PCB thickness has to be set to 1 mm to fit the cases and the cartridge slot. The next one is entirely up to you. Pick a color. Just keep an eye on the price and manufacturing time. Green is usually the cheapest and fastest, while many options have the same price but increase shipping time, as GLC PCB will cluster orders by different customers with similar choices. Some colors, however, are ordered rarely, so they can become significantly more expensive and slower, like in this case yellow. The silk screen, which is the text printed onto the PCB, changes automatically to match your color choice. After you were allowed to be creative with the color choices, the next setting is again very important. While HASL is a solid choice for most PCBs, it is not a good idea for a cartridge that is inserted repeatedly into a slot, as it will wear off. So instead, make sure to select ENIG here, even though it is a bit more expensive. I think that the normal gold thickness is fine. Next section, high spec options. You can leave almost everything on its default here. Normal copper weight and tented wires. You probably do not need to confirm the production file, and you probably don't care about the production number, especially as it will be printed on the rails that you will break off anyway. Leave the flying probe test on, as it can rule out defective PCBs, and turn on gold fingers for our cartridge connector, but don't worry about chamfering and leave castellation off. Okay, with a little help this was not too bad, right? Then enable the switch next to PCB assembly for the next round of options. Up to this point we only have PCBs, but unless you want to solder the components yourself, we need to set up the assembly service too. You can now select which side of the PCB needs assembly. We only need the top side and will solder the cartridge connector ourselves to the bottom side. So PCB A type is stuck on standard anyway, and top side should already be selected. For most of you, PCB A quantity should match the number of PCBs that you chose at the beginning, but if you want to assemble fewer, you can change this here. I highly recommend to complete the next steps for different numbers of PCB A quantities to see if it really is worth to reduce the number here. Next, tell JLC PCB that edge rails and fiducials have been added by the customer. The rails are the sides that you need to break off later, but they are required to hold the PCB during assembly, and fiducials are the small markers at their edges to align the components. Both were already included in my Gerber files, so they were added by the customer. Finally, you probably don't want to confirm the final parts placement. An engineer from JLC PCB will always check the placement and fix errors, and no offense, but if you're watching this guide, these engineers will probably know better than you anyways. They certainly know better than me. Then, after agreeing to some terms and conditions, it is time to tell JLC PCB which components should be placed at which positions. For this, you need to download two more files from my GitHub page. The bill of materials lists the components we need. It is the GB Interceptor underscore PCB underscore BOM dot CSV. Download it and drag it onto the left button. The other file defines where the components need to be placed on the PCB, and on my GitHub page it is called GB Interceptor underscore PCB underscore position dot CSV. Download this one too and drag it onto the right button. Finally, we need to pick an annoying usage description, and we are through with all settings. The next steps should only need our confirmation. The Select Parts page would normally be used to assign components to the component catalog of JLC PCB, but this was all included in my bill of materials. So, with these numbers at the top, everything should be fine and we can proceed to the quote page. Here we can now finally see the assembled PCB in all its glory. You will see the total price without shipping and can buy a fast pass if you want. When you're done enjoying the 3D view, just add the thing to your cart and proceed to the checkout to calculate shipping. This is where I stop holding your hand, because this will now depend on where you live. Unless you are from China, you will probably have a whole range of options, because some of them handle customs for you and others don't. After you placed your order, you can keep track of production and shipping and see the final production files. Don't worry if you see that the JLC PCB engineers rotate a component or two. This is totally normal and they know what they are doing. As far as I know, component orientation can already differ because of different packaging for different feeder types of the pick and place machine. But if you have better insights into this, I would love to learn about this in the comments. Anyhow, this concludes the complicated part of ordering the PCB. In addition to the PCB, you will need a few other parts that you should easily find in different online stores. What you need depends on the case you want to build. The most important part that is needed for both cases is the cartridge connector. You can usually find it at shops for retro console mods, as well as eBay or AliExpress. Look closely at the variant that you buy. You want the version with two bumps on the bottom and pins angled for surface mounting, meaning that they are parallel to the ground like you are seeing here. I think this is the default, but I have seen other versions, so compare product pictures first. If you want to build the minimal case, the only other thing you need is a repro cartridge shell. You should also find it at retro hardware shops, eBay, AliExpress or similar places. Pick any color, but have a look at the position of the large bump inside the shell, as there are two types. For our case, the bump should be near the opening for the connector pins. Now for the more complicated case, the 3D printed one. For this one, you will need a 3D printer or 3D printing service, which, by the way, is also offered by JLC PCB. I assume that most people interested in this version want to print it themselves in step 4, but if you want to order the 3D printed case somewhere, check out the GitHub repository or Thingiverse for the STL file. Besides the printer, the additional parts here are also extremely simple. 3 M2.5 heat set inserts with a length of 4 mm and an outer diameter of 3.5 mm, and 3 M2.5 screws with a length of 4 mm and a flat head. Did you receive everything? Then let's proceed to step 2, the soldering. For both the minimal version and the 3D printed version, you need to solder the cartridge connector to the outlined part of the main PCB. Be aware that this might be different for some community cases. Twist and break off the rails as well as the extension board. Align the cartridge connector with the outline and pads on the PCB and press it into the two holes. Now proceed to solder the two larger pads, which are only for stability, and the 32 small ones. A little bit of flux can make this easier, but it should also work well without additional flux. Do not apply too much solder and make sure to melt it on the heated pad and leads and not on your soldering iron. The next step is uploading the firmware. This should be extremely easy. Once again, visit the release section of my GitHub page. Download gbinterceptor_firmware.uf2 from the latest release. Plug in your interceptor, which should turn on with both the red and blue LED on. On your computer, it should automatically show up as a storage device, like a USB stick. Simply drag the downloaded file into the file system of the interceptor. It should automatically restart with only the red LED turned on. That's it. You can unplug it now. If the interceptor does not show up automatically, or if you want to update the firmware later, you need to press and hold the button near the center with the label flash next to it. When the LEDs turn on, you can release the button and it should show up on your computer, so you can drag a new firmware into it. The final step is adding a case to the interceptor. The minimal version requires a repro cartridge. Simply open it and cut away the closed end. Place the interceptor in the shell and replace the top. That's it. The 3D printed version is a bit more complicated. Of course, the first step here is printing the case. You can find the STL files in the GitHub repository and you will need all three of them. The bottom, the top and the little button. Top and bottom refer to what would be top and bottom for a traditional cartridge. But the bottom has the text GB Interceptor on it that will eventually face you when it is plugged into the Game Boy. Slice the STL files in your preferred slicer with settings suitable for your printer. I use Cura and 0.2 mm layers. The bottom part will require supports. If you're confident with removing them and have a well-configured printer, you can try to rotate the bottom such that the supports are on the inside of the case and the text is facing upwards. This might give a better look, but I found it too hard to remove the supports without damaging the thin walls. When you're done printing, press the heatset inserts into the three holes of the top part and use a soldering iron to melt them into the case. Take care to keep them straight and stop in time for them to be flush with the surrounding bump. Now you can place the interceptor in the case and close it. While doing so, place the little button in the hole of the top part with the thick end on the inside of the case. Finally, insert and tighten the three screws. That's it! Now you should have a working GB interceptor and it is time to try it. One important rule is that the interceptor has to be plugged in before you turn on the Game Boy. So, do that now. It should immediately be available in your system as a webcam. Let's try it in OBS. Just open OBS, add a video source and select the interceptor. When you turn on the Game Boy, things should happen as soon as the Nintendo logo is gone. The blue LED on the interceptor should turn on and the idle screen should be replaced by gameplay footage. Since the interceptor is just a USB video class device, it should be available in any software that can use webcams. That is, unless the software cannot handle the somewhat exotic format. Unfortunately, at the time I am creating this video, the interceptor works with pretty much anything on Linux and it works with some software on Android and Windows. Here it depends on whether the software can handle the strange resolution and slightly less common color format. Fortunately, on Windows you can just use the virtual camera of OBS to feed the interceptor footage to more picky software. On macOS, however, I could not get any video signal. Hopefully, this can be fixed in the future. With this, you should be ready to go. I really hope to see people using the interceptor. If you have any problems, I highly recommend asking on Reddit, and if you encounter bugs, especially if they are specific to different Game Boy models or specific games, please report them as an issue on GitHub. With that, I'm out. Ciao.